Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is the lessons covering the last 3 months of 2014, the months of October, November, and December. This particular lesson is number 6 in that series, and this series is about the book of James. This is the lesson for November 8 of 2014. I'm sure you'll find this very interesting because the lesson is entitled Faith That Works. That sounds like an old Christian discussion, doesn't it? But since you have your Bible handy, hopefully, and you're ready to look at it with us, we'll begin with a word of prayer. We come now, Father, with this perpetual Christian question before us. What is the relationship between faith and works? And we know back in history there have been people who believed that absolutely the only key to salvation was doing all the works that you could possibly do, because that's why you balance the scale in favor of your salvation. And there's other people who said just as vehemently that faith is the only requirement, you don't have to do any works at all. And here we're now going to have a lesson on that. Help us to guide our path through this gauntlet to see if we can get to the right answers is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So what is the relationship between faith and, shall we call them work, shall we call them deeds, or shall we call them actions? And unfortunately, the Bible suggests in a number of places that our lives are going to be laid out before the entire universe, every detail of our lives.
Including our thoughts.
Including our thoughts.
That's a spooky thought.
It is. How do you feel about that? Do you think that our claims to faith will mean anything then if our works don't match those claims?
Maybe I'll feel better after I get a look at Gary's. Maybe I won't feel so bad.
I don't think you're going to have that option.
We're making this class scary.
Well, here's our first verse for this lesson. My brothers and sisters, what good is it for people to say that they have faith if their actions do not prove it? Can that faith save them? And that's our basic question. Can we answer that question?
Notice he said that faith. Mm-hmm. He didn't say faith. He said that faith.
Well, it's the faith that you claim that you have, however much it is. Remember that Jesus says if you have faith like a grain of mustard seed.
He was talking about that faith that has no works. That faith that has no works.
It's the one, yeah, it may be, but it's the one that you say that you have. Let's hope it doesn't have any works, but that's a possibility.
The one that I say I have? The one that you say you have?
The one each of us says we have.
The one Jay says that mm-hmm. he has?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is God really going to embarrass me with displaying all that stuff?
Well, the answer...
Who's going to be interested in all of
that? Why did Jesus erase all that stuff he wrote down on the ground if he wasn't going to embarrass somebody, if he was going to embarrass people?
I don't have time to go into all those details, but I'll read you one very important verse. It's found in Jeremiah 31, starting with verse 31. The Lord, and this is called the New Covenant. The Lord says, the time is coming when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel, with the people of Judah. I wasn't planning to mention this till the end of the lesson, but I'm here doing it up front. It will not be like the old covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt. Although I was like a husband to them, they did not keep that covenant. The new covenant that I will make with the people of Israel will be this. I will put my law within them and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. Now that is presumably the ideal situation. And what's going to be the result? None of them will have to teach his fellow citizen to know the Lord, because all will know me. Will it be true then that to know God is to love him?
And that's eternal life.
That's the question. From the least to the greatest, he says, I will forgive their sins, Gary's sins, Jay's sins, my sins, and I will no longer remember their wrongs. Now, is no longer remember the same as forgetting?
Another way to say it is, I will no longer hold it against them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And as I think as Dick Neese said, God will come up to you and say, when you're
worried
about suffering
about
a sin, you know, God will say, I distinctly remember forgetting that sin of yours.
Yeah.
Pun on word.
You know, when we see that big panorama of our sins and everybody else's sins, that's going to be a pretty ugly thing, isn't it?
It's supposed to be ugly enough so nobody will ever even dream of doing it over again. That's the point. Okay?
But that's not really meant to pummel you into submission. You've already, before you get to that point, you've already made up your mind.
Yeah. All right. Well, James goes on, suppose there are brothers or sisters who need clothes and don't have enough to eat. What good is there in your saying to them, God bless you, keep warm and eat well, if you don't give them the necessities of life? I mean, how can you argue with that? So it is with faith. If it is alone and includes no action, then it is dead. Do we agree with that? Or do we need to go to Romans?
What does it say? Faith works?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I mean, how can you argue with this logic?
No.
Let's put this question as starkly as we can. Does true faith always lead to actions?
Unless you live in a vacuum. I don't know how it couldn't. I mean,
when you drive by the drunk who's standing on the corner with a sign saying needs work, do you wave at him and say, God bless, be warm and eat?
He doesn't say need work. He says need money for beer.
Not always.
He said, why lie? I just need a beer, I think, is
yeah.
the way that
sounds. Oh, really?
That's it.
Sometimes they say that.
Yeah. But they eat, too. They eat and do the other things, too.
It sounds like the road to Jericho logic to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I had a big basket of oranges and I was carrying them, they're a big pile and there's a few too many on there, and so these few too many started rolling off, and you kept picking them back up, and then somebody comes, is hungry over there, they say, here, take these, and then walks off. That's kind of a faith, isn't it? But if a person comes up with this basket, and he's only got three oranges in the basket, mm-hmm. and sees that same person starving, mm-hmm. and takes those three oranges and gives it to him, Which one has the most faith?
Well, God would say it depends on the motive.
Yes.
Well, I would say that the person that had the least amount of oranges and gave it to him would have more mm-hmm. faith, because he'd know he would have to rely on God for his own keep, because his basket's empty now.
Well, but are we talking about faith here as classic faith, or as a relationship here in this particular lesson? One's faith mm-hmm. is one's overall relationships to God. As to
the biblical definition would be that faith is our relationship with God. That would be the definition of faith, a right relationship with God.
Gary, I could take your illustration just a step further. If God has, and I hate to use the word, God has blessed me, okay, and given me that full basket. Mm-hmm. If I give away three of them, I know he's going to continue to bless me because I trust him to take care of me. If he takes all the oranges away from me, so be it. He'll take care of me one way or the other. Is that any different than the guy with the three that gives up his three? He's still got to have faith that God will give him something to eat.
But for sure, the one that only had three, I know he's got faith. But the other one,
you know,
the other one who has a whole bunch of oranges, he might have faith.
Okay, but you know that looking on.
But that's what I'm saying, you know, in the judgment, that there's going to be those kind of things that are going to come up to make your judgment.
Well, if we review the life of Jesus, that's our standard, okay? Gary's not my standard. Jay, I don't know, pick. I'm not your standard. Jesus is our standard. And what we see is that he went out of his way repeatedly to help one person. Now, sometimes he ministered to huge crowds. He fed 5,000 and so forth. But most of the time, he was performing miracles and doing things. He gave some of his greatest sermons to one person, Nicodemus, the woman at the well in Samaria, etc. One person. Now, none of us can meet all of the world's needs. That's just completely impossible. We know that. But could we meet one person's needs at a time, like Jesus did?
And sometimes it's not that we met one person's needs, it's that somehow the story of that gets out, and that affects many lives.
And the example from the Bible, the best example from the Bible of that is the woman who came and gave her two tiny little copper coins into the there. And the the Sadducees, who were counting that money later, probably just checked those things out. I mean, we're counting gold coins here. What's with these two little copper nothings, you know? But Jesus said, that woman has given more than anyone else because two reasons. One, she gave her all. And two, because of the impact it's had on millions of other people.
And it's her faith, it's her relationship that's involved here.
Okay, if we do something out of true faith and true love, does that make the love and faith grow stronger? How would you know that?
Well, I think it would grow stronger because of God's faithfulness will be proven in your life over and over again.
Okay.
That
if you do that and you see the result, you're more inclined to do it again.
Well, especially when you stick your neck out to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
I have
that's
a friend.
Kind of my argument.
I have a friend who finds people in he doesn't go out of his way to find them, but he fairly often runs into people in shopping center parking lots who are asking for food. Of course, what they really want probably is money. So he says to them, you wait right here a little bit. He goes into the store and buys them a bag full of food and comes out and gives it to them. How would that be?
Well, it might be faster just to give them the money.
That's what I do.
Faster and less trouble.
I offered a guy like that granola bars and he didn't want them.
Really?
Well, how old were they?
Well, okay. Now we have to be careful here. James is talking about works here, and we're talking about works. We don't want to give the impression that we think that works is somehow or other going to be saving for us, that we're going to be saved by our works. What's wrong with thinking that we're saved by our works?
We minimize God's grace.
No, you're faking
it on my own.
Yeah.
You're faking it.
I did it on my own. Yeah.
Plus
can we earn our salvation? Wow. Okay, look at the next verse, James 2:18. But someone will say one person has faith, another has actions. My answer is, show me how one can have faith without actions. I will show you my faith by my actions. Okay?
Is that a little bit of kind of gloating also, this, like, when you say that. Because not everyone can, let's say, if you have a certain, not everyone can have, can do this, the same kind of thing. Let's say maybe me, all I can do is pray with someone. Somebody else can, let's say Oprah, she turn around and give a audience calls and what have you. Oh, hey, Oprah, Oprah, Oprah. Not everyone can do those kind of things. Mm-hmm. So I don't think we can measure, you know, whose act is better than the other one.
Okay. Well, can we separate? We're going to compare faith and works. Can we even separate them?
Well, again, I say it lives in a vacuum if you separate them. Mm-hmm.
Can you think of a situation where your faith could grow while you're doing nothing?
Well, you said faith is having a relationship with God, mm-hmm. like knowing a good friend. And if you know what that friend would want you to do for works, and you would happily do them, it's kind of hard to separate the relationship you have with them versus what you know the action should be.
You've got a nice young wife sitting next to you there. Did she expect you to do something before you got married?
No comment.
I think we better ask her.
I didn't mean to put you on the spot, but I mean, we expect that love and relationships are going to cost something, don't we? We expect actions. You know.
I'm not sure about. The word cost bothers me. I'm thinking the person that encounters the Lord, and immediately there is, for the first time, or maybe a. Maybe whatever it is, they're making this encounter, and there's immediate response, it seems like, that I need to change something. I need to change my ways.
Because why? You see something that's better and you want to be like it, right?
Well, sometimes I think in that instance, they're not sure. They just know that what they are isn't, there's something in them that isn't right.
Well, and meaning that you see something that you think at least is mm-hmm. better.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so.
And
do actions always follow faith? I don't think so, because there are people who call themselves atheists or whatever. Let's say, or other people like Buffett, who is giving 95% of his wealth. We're talking about billions of dollars to open school, to do this, to do that. You know, where do we put these people? Because there are people who...
I'm not prepared to say that they're all sinners and going to be lost.
Oh, no, I don't think they will.
Yeah. But we're looking at works as actions of giving financial or food or whatever. It could be the act of sitting and talking with someone.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Listening to someone.
Would it be fair to say that faith and works are like two sides of a coin? But we remember, even if you talk about two sides of the coin, one is heads and the other is tails, right? So faith should always be the lead. In other words, what we're really saying is, if we want the right example to look at, who should we look at?
Jesus.
Always. That's the place to look for an example. Well, we have often heard the idea that James is the works person and Paul is the faith person. What did Paul say about works?
And that was certainly Martin Luther's.
This
faith versus works thing and James versus Paul, that was a struggle for Martin Luther.
Yeah.
So much that Martin Luther wasn't sure that he should include James as part of the Bible.
Right. Yeah.
Well, look at Ephesians 2, verse 10. God has made us what we are, and in our union with Christ Jesus, would that be a description of faith, our union with Christ Jesus? He has created us for a life of good deeds, which he's already prepared for us to do. Sounds like works to me, doesn't it? Look at 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 3. For we remember before our God and Father how you put your faith into practice, how your love made you work so hard, and how your hope in our Lord Jesus Christ is firm.
But the Bible writers have been better to translate the word, instead of works, deeds. Would that have been a better...
That's fine.
Works, certainly in a Christian setting,
well,
has a, it comes with a, it's a real charged...
Unfortunately, the Christian church of many years ago gave works a very bad name. Yeah. Well, look at 1 Timothy 5:25. In the same way, good deeds are plainly seen, and even those that are not so good, not so plain, cannot be hidden. Jesus himself said, remember, what? Let them see your good works and praise your Father in heaven, right? Paul seemed to be suggesting that real faith will cause an outworking of good deeds.
Don't forget Romans 2:13 in that list.
Yeah, let's just look at that. That's another possibility. Look at Romans 2:13. Give me a second, I'll get us there.
I'll read it while you're doing it. For it is not by hearing the law that people are put right with God, but by doing what the law commands.
Yeah. And that's Paul. Yeah. That's not James.
That sure sounds like works to me.
It is. It is.
Well, is it possible? Now, this is not the whole story, but I mean, just one point here. Is it possible for people to see our faith without any works?
I don't think so. Yeah. They can't see them, but but it doesn't mean that they don't have faith, true faith.
Well, if you don't do works, people never know you have faith.
That's right. Yeah. But it's still a possibility that you do, even though you haven't had the opportunity to do the works.
Well, I suppose, but that's not going to last very long.
Well, it wouldn't around here, that's for sure.
Oh, I'm not sure it would last any place. For example, if you have a faith or an understanding about God, no one's ever going to know about that unless you make that known to others verbally or write it or carry out. So and it's my perception that a person who has this welling up of faith, this works is going to come out one way or another.
Well, think about this for a moment. Paul was trying to make the case that there is nothing wrong with good works, but they are never the means of salvation. Do you suppose that Paul, as the former quintessential Pharisee, understood that point? How hard had he tried to win salvation by doing good works?
Very hard.
He thought he was going to wipe out the entire Christian church to win his way to heaven, right? And I quote from Ellen White, if man cannot, by any of his good works, merit salvation, if you can't be qualified for salvation, then it must be wholly of grace, received by man as a sinner because he receives and believes in Jesus. It is wholly a free gift. Justification by faith is placed beyond controversy. And all this controversy is ended as soon as the matter is settled that the merits of fallen man in his good works can never procure eternal life for him. Now, it's very interesting to observe that the date of that statement was 1890. Does that mean anything to anybody?
Mm-hmm. 2 years after 1888 General Conference discussion on this topic.
Righteousness by faith. And just before that conference, what had Ellen White said about our keeping of the law and preaching about the law? She said, we have preached about the law until we are as dry as the hills of Gilboa.
Well, that was our great thing, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, we had the law. We even had the Sabbath. We were keeping the seventh day instead of the first day that everybody else was. So come on, that's our badge. That's mm-hmm. that's our thing.
Well,
there.
Suppose God says, I'm not going to use faith as a requirement anymore for salvation. Here's a long list of things that you have to do. Would you feel better?
It would sure be easier to know, to check them off. Check off 1, 2, 3. Oh, missed 4. I'll have to go back and do number 4.
Well, Paul did have some things that a person should do. He mentioned from different places.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, let's break this works thing down a little bit. Is it important to know the truth? So one of the works could be studying your Bible until you know the truth. Is that important?
Well, you never know the complete truth. You're always learning.
We got the rest of eternity. Doesn't mean we need to start now learning it.
Well, Jesus says you look at the Bible and because you think there's life in it. So how would you explain that as being part of the works?
It testifies of Jesus.
It testifies mm-hmm. of Jesus.
There's a bunch of verses here, but I'm already looking at the clock and realize we're not going to have time. But these verses go along and they make it pretty clear that, and let me just read this one from James, since we're in the book of James. My brothers and sisters, this is James 5, 19 and 20. My brothers and sisters, if any of you wander away from the truth and another one brings them back again, that sounds like truth is pretty important, doesn't it? Remember this, whoever turns a sinner back from his or her wrong way, that would be back from the wrong way to the truth, wouldn't it? Will save that sinner's soul from death and bring about the forgiveness of many sins. That sounds like a good way to go, doesn't it?
You know, if you read that improperly, you could read that as you get points.
Mm-hmm.
You get points if you can save somebody. And I don't think that's the interpretation there.
Okay, well let's bring it right down to the most important point. Do we believe that, quote, to know God is to love Him?
Yes.
To know God is to love Him.
Mm-hmm.
I thought you needed to know Him first before you loved Him.
Well, I mean, this is a growing relationship, hopefully.
Okay, I guess you can. All right.
Well, James has a warning for you. It's found in James 2:19. Do you believe that there is only one God? You've got to know God, you trust Him, you believe Him. Good. The demons also believe and tremble with fear. Didn't Satan, when he was Lucifer, and all the people, all the angels who followed him, didn't they know God very well? Did it save them from being rebels?
The verse you just read, that word fool, is it the same fool that they say, don't call your brother fool? I'm just curious.
I'm not sure. It might be.
We'll chase that down afterwards.
I'm just curious. Every time I see that, I wonder.
Yeah. I'll look it up for you. So, here we are. What's the relationship between getting to know God, faith, actions?
The difference?
Well, what's the relationship? Oh. I didn't say need to be difference. What's the relationship? Is this a sequence? Are these unrelated things? Or
when we know God, we will have faith in Him, trust, belief in Him, and in that relationship, we will want to do the things that draw us closer to Him, which will be actions.
Jesus took a collection of fishermen and tax collectors and, you know, traders and all kinds of people like that and convinced them that the truth and the gospel was so important that they were willing to die for it. Right?
Mm-hmm.
What happened in that process?
Took him a long time to get there.
Yeah.
Did knowing the truth change him?
Yes.
Yes, it did, because that truth overcame death.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the ultimate thing we're afraid of.
There's more than just truth here, or the facts of the case.
Mm-hmm.
Here's that word faith again, a relationship here. They had an identity with this man, with this God, and that's what made them what they became.
Okay, James picks out the obvious example for ancient Jews. Who would you pick out as a great example of faith?
Abraham.
Abraham, of course. He's the father of the faithful, right? So he says, how was our ancestor Abraham put right with God? It was through his actions when he offered his son Isaac on the altar. Genesis 22. You remember the story.
Can I ask, this, the book of James, who is that written to? Is this
it's
the Christian
written to
church?
The early Christians, yes, the early Christians, who were mostly Jews.
So in his illustration, could it be argued that one reason he pulled Abraham in here as an example was because of the identity that Jews had mm-hmm. to Abraham? Not only did it make but he's really wanting to have these Jews mm-hmm. really catch their attention.
Yeah. Well, it was through his actions, he goes on to say, when he offered his son Isaac on the altar. Can't you see? His faith and his actions worked together. His faith was made perfect through his actions. What does that perfect mean?
Mature.
Mature. It means even ripe. A perfect fruit is a ripe fruit. See, the word means mature. Isn't God looking for some mature Christians? Well, and the scripture came to that said Abraham believed God, and because of his faith, God accepted him as righteous. And so Abraham was called God's friend. You see then that it is by people's actions that they are put right with God and not by their faith alone.
Don't you think, though, that back then being put right by faith didn't necessarily mean that the works were being good? Being completely right at the time. I mean, the first thing that Abraham did was give up his wife.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of faith is that?
It's very interesting. Well, there's two or three things interesting about this story. The story is discussed by several people down through scriptures. And several points are made. The first of all, it's very clear in Genesis that Abraham was blessed by God because of his faith before he was circumcised.
Yeah.
To the Jew, that's a very key point. He was blessed by God and promised a son and all that stuff before he was circumcised.
But that's against Jewish thinking.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's why James is mentioning it.
So what's the point of that?
Well, because the Jews that James is writing to are trying to say basically, no, you've got to be Jewish, you've got to be circumcised, you've got to do all these things. Then we'll talk about whether you can be a Christian.
Okay, so he's pointing in on the circumcision.
Okay. And then he goes on to make another couple of points, very interesting points. The people who later on in the story discuss Abraham as a great man of faith, they never discussed Abraham's lying. They never discussed his take, well, Paul sort of does, but in a different kind of a way. The fact that he wasn't supposed to take Hagar as his wife.
So those are mentioned in Genesis, but not in Romans and here in James
He mentions Hagar in Galatians, but it's in a different context. He uses just as, okay, this is an example of doing things the right way, and this is an example of doing things the wrong way.
Cognitive dissonance.
Yeah.
What is the Jewish perception of Abraham's faith?
Well,
having mostly the Old Testament stories to go by about the experience in Egypt and so on, seemed to be an awful lot of times when he didn't have much faith.
But remember, the Jews don't have the New Testament. They don't believe that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, so that, man of Galilee, etc. So they're looking for people, for an outstanding example of faith in the Old Testament, and Abraham is it. I mean, he was willing through all that trials and waiting all that time and so forth, and he finally says, okay, I'm willing to, if God, if you tell me, I am willing to take my son and offer him as a sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Now, let's think about that for a moment. Do you think that was easy for Abraham?
No.
Did it require a very committed relationship to God?
I think it depends on how you look at it. It can be somebody who's really has self-survival. I don't think I could do it, no matter how much I believe. And because I wouldn't believe if God gave me a child, he would want me to kill it. So I wouldn't do it. I would think that's coming from someplace else. That's not, doesn't have God in it.
Well, yeah, because you're not used to killing things as sacrifices for your sins, etc. But to Abraham, and we need to make a subtle distinction here, but it's hard for us in our Western way of thinking to do this. But to Abraham, he was not killing Isaac, he was offering Isaac. To him, he was giving Isaac to God. That's what he was doing. And but we need to understand that.
Back in his time, though, the pagan concept was that the ultimate thing you could do for your God was to offer your son, offer your firstborn. Yeah. But I just had pointed out a few weeks ago when he was told to take the ram. He wasn't supposed to take a lamb. That was a ram, and a ram was the ancient god, a symbol of all the ancient gods back then. So it says God will provide himself a lamb, but take that ram, which is a symbol of the ancient heathen deities, kill that ram, kill that concept of a god.
If God wouldn't have stopped Abraham from sacrificing his son, would his image of God have changed afterwards?
Well, it would depend on what happens next. Remember that the Bible says that he finally concluded, the reason he was sort of willing to go through with this, he says, God, I know from my experience with you that you're going to work things, everything is going, you're going to work it out somehow or other. So he believed that if he actually killed Isaac, God would find a way to bring him back to life.
That's Hebrews 11:19.
Mm-hmm. Hebrews 11:19. So Abraham had that all worked out. After 3 days and three nights of constant conversation with God, he didn't sleep for three nights. Mm. And he was walking during the day.
And I think that is a very big component here, is that Abraham had a very familiar relationship mm-hmm. with God. He had been visited by mm-hmm. God upon several occasions, it appears. And so, whereas if somebody showed up at me in the middle of the night and told me to take my son out, I might worry.
You would not do it.
But Abraham knew this guy. He knew this God.
And that's exactly the point, right? We are supposed to get to know God. And then we can, I mean, God doesn't test us all in that same way, but each one of us will have our own testings. And if we know God well enough so that when God says something, we say, God, I'm on my way, but let me ask questions. That's exactly, you see, Job and Abraham and others, Jeremiah and others like that, were God's friends because while when God said go, they went, but they felt comfortable with God and they were asking questions. They said, God, I need to understand why you're asking me to do this.
There's a difference.
They were not disrespectful.
There's a difference between Jeremiah and Abraham, it appears to me. Abraham was asked to do something that seemed, in a way, clearly off the wall here. And I can't help but feel that Abraham and Job were almost kind of a similar experience. When I look at it, and here's another Job. God took Job and said, hey, watch this guy.
Yeah.
And in the setting of the great controversy, and this is about the only way I can come up with some kind of an explanation of why Abraham was in this situation, is that God is saying once again, hey, watch, you saw what would happen with Job, now you watch, see how Abraham responds to me.
Turn to patriarchs and prophets. Look at the chapter entitled, I believe it's called Test of Faith, the story about God, Abraham taking and offering Isaac, and read the last few chapters, the last few couple of pages, and it says there that God was saying, here, Satan was traveling around the universe and says, look at this guy, Abraham, that God calls his friend. He's lying, he's, you know, taking on other wives, etc., to try to fulfill you. He doesn't trust you enough to even give him a child, etc. Look at this guy. These are the kind of people that God calls his friends. And God says, watch this.
Which was different than Job. In Job, Job was righteous. He didn't do anything wrong. He was a righteous man. But here we have someone who is not so righteous.
It reminds me, a few weeks ago we read a quote from Ellen White, God judges the sin to the sinner, or, you know, I forget the quote.
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't judge, he judges some sins differently for different people.
Steps to Christ, page 30.
Yeah, and it's similar. I mean, sometimes you can focus in on someone's life, but it's their life, and God works with them. So.
It's a direction of their life. Would that sense?
Yeah, it's the direction of their life. It's interesting to notice that in Revelation 14, verse 4, let me just read that. Revelation, we're going to jump out of our James book for just a moment. Look at Revelation 14, verse 4. Now, this is just before our famous key text, which is Revelation 14, 6 through 12, right? The three angels' messages. Right before that, Revelation 14, verse 4, talking about these saints, the 144,000, they are the men who have kept themselves pure by not having sexual relationship with women. They are virgins. And Ellen White says what that's talking about, are these are people who've developed a pure faith. So if you wonder what that's talking about. But notice what it says next. They follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Where did the Lamb go?
To the cross.
To the cross.
Lost his life.
Are God's faithful people willing to follow him to the cross?
I think so. I think I'd follow
Jesus. And that he couldn't fake.
No.
That was mercy that could not be faked. You can.
Okay, look at James 2:22. We're moving along here. Can't you see his faith and his actions, talking about Abraham still, his faith and his actions worked together. His faith was made perfect, mature, ripe, through his actions. What do you think Abraham said to his wife when they got home?
Can't imagine.
Aren't we glad to have this son? Aren't we glad we had the faith?
I don't know, did Sarah know too much about this?
What Jay brought up, the parallel between Abraham and Job. Both of those, though, in a way, were God's demonstration of God's foreknowledge. God used Job, he's a righteous guy. Mm-hmm. Abraham, I can still trust him. Job, Abraham has now learned, and he can be trusted. So I like that, Jay.
Yeah. Well, what here it talks about...
It's actually God is able to judge our character.
Right. Yeah, he knows.
He's able to judge the character of Job and Abraham and obviously us too. Yeah.
Let me go back to this passage I just read to you and look at the last part. His faith was made perfect through his actions. We said the word perfect means mature, ripe. You know, that's exactly the same word that we find in Matthew 5:48. Where it says, be ye therefore perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. You must be perfect in my Good News Bible. Same thing.
It's been said that it's an offer, not a command. But don't we want to have a perfect father? Do we want one that's just stumbling and bumbling and learning on the job? No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, us theologians.
But what God is simply saying in both of these cases, James is saying, God says back in Matthew 5, is, I would like you to grow up. I want you to grow up. Okay? Well, can you think of an example from your own faith experience with Christianity where works built your faith? I want to ask you to answer that. Just think about it. And then we come to the other side of the coin. Look at James 2, verse 25. It was the same with the prostitute Rahab. She was put right with God through her actions by welcoming the Israelite spies and helping them to escape by a different road. So then, he draws a conclusion, as the body without the spirit is dead, spirit is another word for what? Breath, right? The body without the breath is dead, so also faith without actions is dead. It's pretty clear how he feels about it, isn't it? Well, James 2:25. What do we know about Rahab?
Well, she was a prostitute.
In Jericho. Mm-hmm.
And
the city of the moon, where they worshiped the moon god, the god of fertility.
She's one of the forebears of Jesus.
How did she get to be like that?
Well,
she was the great-grandmother of David. Of course, it took a few things to happen in between.
And she was also observing what was happening with these Israelites as they came wandering through the desert before they got to Jericho. They were hearing these stories, and she was...
They knew about the plagues in Egypt. Mm-hmm. They knew about the crossing of the Red Sea. They knew about the fight with the Amalekites and the others that they'd fought with. They knew about the fight with the Midianites. They knew about the fight with the Amorites that had happened up north. And you know, the Jews had just, there was just no comparison. I mean, they just sailed through those, so long as they followed God's will for them, they just sailed through all those battles like, you know, there was nothing that would stop them.
She also knew about the manna, mm-hmm. and the fire mm-hmm. at in the night and the cloud by day.
So now, is Rahab one of these people of the culture of those days who said, well, here's another god and he looks pretty powerful, so I'll embrace him too?
Well, what did she do?
Is she having a real conversion experience?
Yeah. What did Rahab actually do?
She lied.
She hid the spies under the flax on the roof.
And lied about it.
Okay. Before you talk about her lying.
But that's the important part.
She intended to deceive the people that were her fellow.
Okay, so now I'm gonna put you on the spot. If you were lying under the flax on the roof, what would you be praying?
Help me not to sneeze.
help me not to scratch.
Well, serious. I mean, we say, we look at the conclusion, and I'm like, wow, that worked out great, didn't it? We don't think about the step-by-step, you know, what would you do at any given point?
It describes Rahab as saying, I think it was before she hid them, we know about your God.
No, after she hid them.
Was it after?
After she had lied, she went upstairs and says, we know about you, and we know, and you promised me, and they said, that's right. If you put this red cord out your window, you and everyone who's in this house will be saved. Did they have to have faith too?
To stay in the house.
Enough faith to stay in the house.
And everything else was falling.
And Rahab ended up doing what? Marrying one of the leading men of the tribe of Judah and becoming an ancestor of Jesus.
Great-grandfather of David. Great-grandmother of David.
Well, just as Rahab knew these stories, it says, Ellen White says, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 492, all these events were known to the inhabitants of Jericho, and there were many who shared Rahab's conviction, though they refused to obey it. What does, now remember, our discussion is about faith and works, right? So how does this fit in? How much faith did it require to go to Arab's house and say, I want to get in here, I want to be here?
Well, this doesn't match our concept of faith, which has a natural consequence of works.
Why not?
Well, because they had the faith, but the works weren't a natural consequence.
Oh, you mean these people?
Right, yes.
Okay, well,
my understanding, that passage says that these people had the same faith, but they didn't manifest the same works.
Here's the problem. In modern times, we have drawn a distinction between faith and belief, which really wasn't there in the Bible, but he's already solved that problem by talking about who else that has, quote, faith?
Abraham.
Well, and before Abraham? The devils, right? They believe.
They knew.
They knew God, and yet they rebelled.
So they have faith.
It's the same word in Greek. Okay. There's no difference. There's only one word, pistis. Means faith, belief, conviction.
The only difference is that they hate God.
Mm-hmm.
So that's their works. When they see these works happening, you'll be able to tell by their works that they hate God.
Mm-hmm. Well, Rahab ends up being in one of those fantastic women who make the honor roll in Matthew 1.
Immanuel Kant would not agree with Rahab. Yeah. Can't lie.
He didn't like her.
Well,
James comes to some interesting conclusions. Look at verse 26, the last verse in chapter 2. So then, we read this before, but let's think about this for a moment. So then, as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without actions is dead. Is that true?
Well, true. He says it a couple times there, so sure, he believes it. I think it makes sense.
So why is he saying that?
Because it's true.
No. He didn't make it up.
A lot of things he could have said that were true. Why is he saying this here and now? Why is he feeling it's necessary to include it in this letter, this document, to these people?
Okay, well, and to help you with answering that question, I'm going to ask you, why did he pick Abraham and Rahab? I mean, how could you pick any greater contrast? Abraham was the great father of the nation. He was the one that everybody looked to as a great example of faith. Who was Rahab? She was a woman. She was a prostitute. She was a Canaanite.
Gentile.
Couldn't get more opposite.
No, but they were both flawed.
Yeah.
They were both flawed.
Do you know anybody that's flawed?
Everyone.
There's a couple of people at this table, but it's on the other side over there.
Is that true?
Only because the table's big enough we can't kick him.
Well, Ellen White says in comment, when self is put entirely away, would that mean when love dominates our lives? Then you can obtain a new and rich experience. You will discern your own imperfections as you lie low at the foot of the cross. And as you view the perfections of Christ, self will sink into insignificance. Christ will appear to the discerning eye, would we dare to say the discriminating eye, the perfection of attractive loveliness. Jay, weren't you the one who was talking about if you look at Jesus? Then his mold will be upon mind and heart, and will be revealed in the character. What happens here?
Character change.
The character is changed. We become like Jesus.
As we often say here, by beholding, become changed.
The impress of the divine mind should be made upon the heart and manifested in the life. Come to Jesus in your need. Pray in living faith. Hold fast to the hand of divine power. Believe, only believe, and you will be, and that's have faith, only have faith, and you will see the salvation of God. If you will be taught, God will teach you. Gary, you asked about that. I'm saying God is waiting for us. He says, just give me a chance, I'll teach you. He will lead you to fountains of living waters, testimonies to Southern Africa. Ellen White, page 26. So what are we to conclude? What is the relationship between faith and works? Well, we've talked about it being two sides of a coin. Ellen White has these interesting words. Faith and works are the two oars with which we are to make our way in the Christian life. The Lord calls upon all who think they know what faith is to be sure that they are not pulling with only one ear oar and their little bark going round and round making no progress at all. Faith without intelligent works is dead, quoting James. Faith in the healing power of God will not save unless it is combined with good works. Wow, manuscript 86, 1897, quoted in some places that are no longer available generally.
Does our faith sometimes make us work? We have to work because, you know, I need to do this because...
I once gave a sermon in Africa to the people there, and I said, you know, here I am, this white man, talking to a bunch of people from Africa, and I said, I am a slave. Paul was a slave. What makes me a slave? Because I have this conviction burning inside me that I need to tell people about Jesus. And I can't keep quiet about it. That makes me a slave. That's what Paul said. What do we make of that? Well, our lesson, our Bible study guide says, faith is a works aren't just supposed to be an outward sign, something we do on the outside to be seen. Faith is supposed to be an outworking. I mean, works are supposed to be an outworking of faith. Our faith actually working its way out from our character, working its way out. Many of us have been Christians all our lives and probably still struggling with the exact relationship between faith and works. This may be partly because of the apparent contrast we know about Martin Luther. But if we really practiced agape love, if we really act out of principle, we really want to be as much like Jesus Christ as we possibly can, so we study his life and get to understand why he did what he did so that we can do what we do following those principles, a marvelous change will take place in our lives. And if enough of us did that, we would find our way into the kingdom of God and be able to ask God all those questions which we don't have the answers to right now. Have a great week. Our wonderful Father, we thank you for being with us through this presentation and helping us to do our best to represent you. May what they hear be the pure truth, not what we have said, but what it's been, as it has been transformed by your Holy Spirit, so they may hear what they need to hear, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.